Good afternoon. I'm Chris Scherer, Member Communications Director of the Society of Broadcast Engineers and the co-host of this month's episode of the SBE WebXtra, the SBE chapter of the web. This is a monthly SBE meeting usually held on the third Monday of the month. The SBE is the Association for Broadcast and Multimedia Technology Professionals with about 5,000 members, mostly in the U.S., but also around the world. The SBE WebXtra is sponsored by Catrine. Catrine, unique experience, individual solutions, reliable performance. The host of today's SBE WebXtra is SBE board member Kirk Harnack, who is also the chair of the SBE Social Networking Committee. Good afternoon, Kirk.
Good afternoon, Chris, and thank you very much. We're looking forward to a very interesting show today, and we have, I think, one of the best explainers on the planet to tell us about the technology and the techniques of what's going on. Chris, our show today has to do with transitioning in a big market, market number one in the U.S., transitioning some of those TV stations over to what's called NextGen TV or ATSC 3.0. And at least we'll go ahead and say hi to him real quickly here before of our member update. Skip Pizzi is coordinating that for the WNET, the public stations there. Skip, welcome in. Good to see you.
Thanks, Kirk. Good to see you all. I'm glad to be here. Thanks.
Hey, give us the quick elevator pitch on what we'll be talking about after Chris makes our member update for us.
Sure. We'll be talking about NextGen TV, as you said, ATSC 3.0, the standard a little bit, and the special challenges we have in this country of putting it on the air without any new spectrum, transitioning from current what's DTV, digital television, called ATSC 1.0 now, retrospectively, to 3.0, in particular, the way it's going to happen in the New York market, as you mentioned.
And I think there's some things you're going to pass along to us that that have to do with coordinating the transitions. There's a method that the FCC had in mind, but there may be some better methodology. By the end of today's show, Skip is going to teach us about the word a lighthouse and about the word the phrase dance partner. So that's coming up when we get done with our member update. So Chris Scherer, you've got a member update for us, and all you SBE members, pay close attention because this is good stuff.
Yes, Chris. Yes, I do. And here is your SBE member update for February 21st, 2022. The next live webinars by SBE is on Friday, February 24th at 2 p.m. Eastern Time. The topic is Introduction to Successful Troubleshooting. Dan Fogel, the founder and former CEO of DNF Controls, will explore effective troubleshooting by providing insights on thought processes required to be the most effective, including how to be successful when dealing with areas you don't know or are not comfortable with. Beginning in April, webinars by SBE will launch a new 8-part series on CBNT and CBNE study topics. The SBE Broadcast Networking Certification exams evaluate many aspects of the IT side of broadcasting, and Wayne Pacina will cover several key areas of study to help you prepare to take the SBE CBNT or CBNE certification exam. For information on these and all the webinars by SBE, go to sbe.org/webinars. If you are SBE certified, check the expiration date. Many certifications were due for renewal on January 1st. If yours says January 1, 2022, you need to submit your recertification or apply to advance your certification to the next level right away. The next SBE certification exam window at local chapters is in June. The application deadline for that exam session is April 15th. And with the upcoming NAB show being planned, there might be an SBE certification exam session. Watch the SBE website, SBE News, and social media if this is arranged. If a local chapter exam is not convenient for you or not possible because of in-person restrictions, private proctoring is available. More information on SBE certification is online at sbe.org/certification. The annual SBE National Awards Program recognizes those who have contributed to the SBE, the industry, or their chapters in a number of categories. Winners are presented awards at the National Awards Dinner at the annual SBE National Meeting in the fall. Some SBE members go above and beyond the call of duty to do their job and to serve the SBE and broadcast industry. There are local chapters that do an excellent job of serving their members. Often these efforts go unrecognized. Complete an awards nomination form and recognize a deserving individual or chapter. Get more information and access the forms at sbe.org/awards. And is your chapter still meeting virtually? You should report those meetings to the national office just as you would an in-person meeting. These count toward the minimum 5 meetings held during a calendar year necessary for a chapter to qualify for an annual rebate. I'm hearing from chapters that many are beginning to meet again in person now that vaccination rates are increasing. Chapters, be sure to share your chapter meeting photos on the SBE Chapters Facebook group. And the annual SBE membership drive begins March 1st and runs until the end of May. When you recruit new members, you not only help grow the SBE, but you can win prizes for your efforts. The grand prize is a trip to the SBE National Meeting in the fall. And even if you don't win a prize in the drawing, each approved new member application you sponsor will earn you $5 off your 2023 membership dues, up to $25. If you recruit 3 or more regular or associate members, or 1 SBE sustaining member, you will also receive an upgrade to SBE Member Plus for the remainder of the 2022 membership period. Applications must be received at the national office between March 1st and May 31st of this year to be eligible. You can get more info on the membership drive at sbe.org/drive. And that is your SBE member update for February 21st, 2022.
Chris, thanks so very much. And Chris, you know well our guest for today, Skip Pizzi. I'm sure you two have worked together, crossed paths many times, haven't you?
Yeah, he was my opening act in a previous life.
Skip, I see your name popping up in the news frequently, and then every few years it seems like you're on to another adventure. And tell us about this adventure in New York City. What are you going to be doing?
Right. Well, it's a thrill actually to be working with the public broadcasters in New York to transition to the NextGen TV format and system. I imagine viewers here today kind of get what NextGen TV is. It's sort of self-explanatory by the title, as you'd expect, but it is a big shift technically. For consumers, it'll hopefully give them more and better content, higher quality and higher quantity. It's allowing broadcasters to pack a whole lot more content on their 6 megahertz channels than they can currently today with ATSC 1. And it also allows them to offer the latest and greatest in terms of video and audio systems, going beyond the 1080i that is kind of the max that ATSC 1.0 allows, all the way up to UHD 4K with HDR and higher frame rates when they're becoming available in terms of the content that's offered by broadcasters. Also, immersive sound going beyond stereo and 5.1 audio and into 3D, total immersion of sound, and adapting to a lot of the other new consumer electronics technologies that can provide that sort of either virtually or with actual hard speakers around and overhead and so forth. Also then more of the interactive television, a way to really get interactive TV to kind of finally work after it's been something that's been poked around with for literally decades. And now we're seeing it potentially really going to happen this time. There's one thing under the hood that most folks won't notice, but it's pretty important, is that it's converting television, broadcast television, to an IP-based system, which has never been done before. And so that's a pretty big deal in terms of what it allows, particularly on that interactive side. And one other element that it really, that's pretty cool about what it allows, is the ability to match or to mix, really, broadcast and broadband services. Today, pretty much every TV you buy has an internet connection on it, either by Ethernet or Wi-Fi. And you typically switch between the conventional TV broadcast input, an F connector, either off-air antenna or through a cable set-top box or some other a delivery format for regular linear television, it's called, or you switch over to the web for your internet connection to stream television. There's a lot of services there, and it's either or. What this service allows in ATSC 3 would allow you to mix the two inputs to get a single program that you're watching that has some of its content coming in over the air through the traditional input, and other content that you can choose, you as the user, the viewer, can choose to use or not use other elements that are offered alongside by the broadcaster that are fed on the internet, via the internet. And then you can choose to display them. You could even choose to send them to a second screen, like a handheld device or a tablet that you're also watching at the same time. So basically updating television to what people have gotten used to in the interim since we went from analog to digital television. But now that the internet has kind of made the entire customer base, viewers of television, used to other kinds of things, other personalized experiences, shall we say, and also that the world has moved to IP. So this is a real forklift upgrade to get television into the current day and have competitive services. Broadcasters also like a couple of other things about it, that it would allow targeting of advertising, which of course the internet does very well. And advertisers have gotten used to having that capability and are now asking for more than just how many eyeballs you got per dollar. Now it's how can I target to, how can I figure out who the best audience for this ad is? And so television will, if the broadcaster wants to offer it, through ATSC 3.0, the broadcaster can offer that some kind of targeting to its advertisers to allow it to the broadcast industry, the commercial broadcast industry, to also offer that kind of new capability that advertisers have gotten used to getting if they want it. In the intervening years since the DTV transition, again, because of the capabilities of, that we've all gotten used to on the internet. So that's NextGen TV in a nutshell. And you can see why broadcasters and some, to some extent, consumers are going to benefit from this and want to go through the process. However, it's not backward compatible to the current system, so it takes a bit of doing to put it on the air, just like it, we had to go through with converting in that major way from analog NTSC in this country TV to DTV with ATSC 1.0. But in that case, there was a spectrum to allow broadcasters to run both services in parallel for a while until enough people came along with the new capability to receive the digital, and then the analog could go away over many years of transition. Well, we don't have that spectrum anymore, or we don't have, we've gone through, when we did that transition, we gave up a bunch of spectrum. And once we settled on the new single digital service, and that spectrum then again in turn was auctioned off by the government to wireless companies and wireless communications companies, cellular phones and so forth. And then since then we've had yet another spectrum auction, as it was called, an incentive auction in this case, just to get more spectrum from television over to the wireless carriers. And so we're really squeezed down now and have no extra spectrum to do this television transition. And so this has caused the process of transition to be much more involved, let's say, than just lighting up another signal for a while and running to ATSC 1 and 3 in parallel. And it's being done through channel sharing. And that's kind of where all these new terms like lighthouse and so forth have come about.
You know, wow, you answered a couple questions there before I even got to answer them. So thank you for predicting that. And as you said, when we went from analog television, NTSC analog, to what we have now, ATSC 1.0, as we call it now, stations were given two channels, and they're going to have to give one up. There was a sunset on the NTSC, and then they would just be left with their digital channel. And this is when stations also, most of them moved off of their traditional channel assignment, and the PSIP technology allowed them to still advertise. Hey, we're still on channel 5. Well, okay, we're transmitting on channel 21, but we're channel 5 to you. And that's what the scanning was about. You'd rescan your receiver, you'd find all the RF out there. The signal in the RF would tell your TV what channel to think it really was. And so channel 5 would still show up on channel 5, and channel 12 would still show up on channel 12. So that was an interesting use of technology. And I think we're going to be using that a lot more with the transition. Now, back to this thing that we used to have. For the previous transition, TV stations could transmit both things at the same time under their own control, under their own power. They would typically own both transmitters and both antennas, and they may have rented tower space, but they owned everything. You have a different challenge if you're a TV station transitioning over to ATSC 3.0. I don't think there's a sunset, at least not in the U.S., on turning off your 1.0. I mean, heck, people are still buying, 1.0 TV sets right now. And there's no additional spectrum for stations to have too. So, Skip, walk us through what typical markets will do. I live in Nashville, Tennessee. We have I think you'd call it a lighthouse station. One of the TV stations has utilized their ATSC 3.0 or their channel to carry a number of the other TV station's signals, including their own. And this is going to go on for some years. How does that compare with other markets, and is New York City going to be any different with you managing a project for the public broadcasters?
Right. Well, you set that up well. That is kind of the transition scheme right now. This time around, first of all, the FCC is not mandating that this transition happen, and as a result, they have no schedule for it. So it's purely voluntary on the part of the broadcasters. It's also voluntary on the part of the consumer electronics companies. Today, if you want to sell something and brand it as a television, it has to have a 1.0 ATSC 1.0 receiver in it, as we've known for many years, for it to sell it in this country. that's going to continue, of course. But right now, what we're seeing is that most of the top manufacturers of TVs in this country are starting to add 3.0 capability to their TVs as well. So the tuner is a ATSC 1.0/3.0 dual receiver that automatically senses whether a channel coming in that it's receiving is a 1.0 or a 3.0 signal and switches to that transparently. They've had TVs like this for years, a couple years now at least, going on longer in Korea, where this standard is also in use. And there they have a mandate, they have a schedule, they even have a 1.0 sunset, ATSC 1.0 sunset date over there. But over here, it's all voluntary. And we're lucky to see that how many consumer electronics companies are already offering 3.0 in their sets. Sony's current line, the entire line, is now ATSC 1.0, 3.0 capable. So if you buy any Sony TV new today, it will have that capability, NextGen, just built in. And the other manufacturers also are offering it, perhaps not through their entire lines yet, but each model year, actually every 6 months they refresh the model year. It's a model half year, really. They are adding more and more, starting at the top and usually and working their way down. And so pretty soon, within a couple of years, I would say, you won't, as a consumer, be able to buy a new set that doesn't have 3.0 receiving capability, NextGen TV built in. And there'll be a logo. There is a logo currently already that the Consumer Technologies Association has worked up, and there's tests that are have been developed and more all the time that to authorize a manufacturer to be able to use that logo, NextGen TV, it says on the box, on the set. So that's all happening, and it's nice that it's all happening voluntarily. So we don't need that mandate. It's good for flexibility for the broadcasters to do it at their own pace. Nevertheless, you want to come along and do it. And how do you do it without spectrum? So given that, the FCC also, to their credit, understood that this was going to be a challenge to do. And so they actually changed their rules to allow broadcasters to cooperate in a way that they've never done, at least in this country, before. And that is sharing a channel across multiple licensees. And so as you started to explain there, what happens in this so-called lighthouse arrangement, and this was the way it was kind of thought out before the new rules were written and proposed by broadcasters, led largely by the NAB at the time, and working with that group and also with the Pearl Consortium, putting together some of these ideas to figure out how could we actually do this, and then asking for those rules changes, and the FCC has done that. And they said at that time, which was, I guess, going back almost a couple of years now, we'll revisit this in 5 years and see where the transition is at and see if we need to make any more rules changes. So at least for this period, we've got these rules that allow this to happen. And again, just to the mechanics of it are, let's say you have five stations in a market that want to work together to all convert to NextGen TV, to 3.0. Well, first thing you do is have one of them decide to do that, and it turns off its 1.0 transmission on its channel, because it only has that one channel, and turns on its 3.0 transition, and carries all the services that of the other participating stations, those other four stations, along with their own signal, as you said, on in 3.0. Now, 3.0 can carry about five times as much content as the as 1.0 can do. So that's easy enough to do, to squeeze all those channels in high quality on that new 3.0 service that is still owned and operated and licensed to that one broadcaster, but that broadcaster is carrying all those other four stations along with its own content in the new 3.0. But what happens to users that still have the old sets? How do they get that station that turned off its 1.0 signal now until they get a new 3.0 set? Well, the other stations have a sort of reciprocal arrangement with that one station that went 3.0, and they spread around in their 1.0 bandwidth the best they can the content that used to be in 1.0 on the station that's now converted to 3.0. So let's say that station had a main signal that was a network program stream, like most stations do. Plus, they might have had one or maybe two multicast channels. Maybe one of like MeTV or one of these, you know, old rerun channels that are popular now. Maybe a weather radar low bandwidth signal as well. And so somewhere along the in the bandwidth of the other four ATSC 1.0 stations, that those other services are carried. Maybe one's on one station and one's on another and the other. So across the four of them, they're carrying in 1.0 the old stations, the 3.0 stations, old 1.0 service. And so there's nobody left out. And the rules that these new rules that the FCC came up with mandate that the coverage of those other stations carrying the former 1.0 content on the from the 3.0 station has to cover pretty much the same area that 3.0 station used to cover, when it carried those signals itself. And so that's part of the process. And if you don't cover it, then you've got to come up with what they call mitigation strategies, which generally means if somebody needs this a set-top box, you got to provide it, you being the broadcaster. Or in some cases, maybe it's this consortium of broadcasters that have put together a deal where they would share that cost. And that's step one. And then little by little, a second of those five stations will convert to 3.0, and then a third, and so on. And meanwhile, somehow you got to keep carrying all those other services, that stations that go 3.0, they still have to have their 1.0 signal carried. Well, remember, 1.0 doesn't carry a lot of content. You only have a little less than 20 megabits. And you really have to start squeezing with that old compression technology from the 1990s called MPEG-2 video. You can't squeeze it down very, you can't squeeze an HD signal down very much. So as you get towards the end of this process, you probably are going to have to start putting some of those services on in SD. And ultimately, you end up with one station that's still broadcasting out of that group in 1.0. And sometimes call that the nightlight station. That's the kind of, for those who have yet to convert. But whether or not you're going to be able to get HD for all the services, at least the main channel service, is going to be tough. So that's going to be a trick, but we assume it would help consumers stimulate them to get their new 3.0 set in place. And if not, there's a set-top box option that would allow them to not be ruled out, just like we had in the DTV transition for those last adopters, except that in that case, the government didn't totally fund it, but underwrote some of the costs. You got a certificate, a couple of certificates to apply. So, but this case, it won't be. There's no government subsidy to do that. So that's the process that's been set up as the so-called lighthouse transition. Channel sharing is probably a better term for it, because that's exactly what stations are doing.
There's another kind of transition you're going to chat about shortly, but yeah. Earlier we mentioned PSIP, the technology that lets mm-hmm. my TV think that, hey, I'm tuning to channel 5, or it's really, I don't know, RF21 or something. But I understand that PSIP will allow me to think I'm tuned to channel 5 when really I'm on another station's RF, a subchannel like 17.2. My TV still thinks I'm tuned to channel 5. So my brand identity, my channel identity, I get to keep that, and it's not confusing right. to consumers, as long as they hit the scan button and scan when they should.
Yeah.
The TV operates, they think, as normal, right?
Exactly. And that was something that was put into ATSC 1.0 to allow, as you said, that to happen when they converted from analog to digital, and they wanted to keep their old analog channel number. In some cases, they'd stayed on that same RF channel ultimately when right. they were done, because you could pick either one. That, you know, you were on, say, channel 7, and then you got a new channel, say 46, at the time that was available. Now, nowadays, it's nothing over 37, I guess, 36. So you got, say, channel 32, and that you could put your digital on that, and you could stay when analog sunset went away. You had your choice in most cases to say, I'm going to put my keep my digital on 32, or I'm going to put my digital now back on my old channel 7. In any event, one or the other of those two channels became your new digital RF channel, as we're calling it now. But your identity channel, your virtual channel, if it would be whatever you wanted it to be, which was typically your old number. And the mm-hmm. PSIP data stream was what is in that new digital signal that tells the receivers, well, this is what you used to call channel 7, but it's now actually coming in on channel 32. But you don't know that. I mean, the user doesn't know the actual RF channel. All it gets is the identity of the channel. So that was done for that purpose. But you're right, it was done for the entire channel. Well, that same concept applies to the individual sort of what they're called subchannels or multicast services or minor channels and regulatory speak. You can do that for individual minor channels too, and they are independent of what RF channel they're being carried on. And that's what's being used this time. That capability is already in all the old 1.0 sats, and broadcasters can use that so that now this other broadcaster that's carrying a different broadcaster's content on one of its subchannels will just be just as transparent to the user as was the case with the analog to digital transition, where the whole channel just shifted over and any services on it all kept that same major channel number. Now you're mixing and matching major and minor channels, and as long as you do the rescan, it's still channel 7 to you, even though it's now being carried by channel 22.3, let's say. So that's, yeah, and that's PSIP's value here. This is like they used to say, it's you're trying to take a fully loaded 747 and offload all the passengers and cargo onto 5 737s while they're all in the air without the passengers knowing it's happening. It's kind of what we did, and it to some extent, but with the DTV transition, but we're doing it again now in even more sliced and diced deck shuffling kind of way.
Oh, and more than that, the passengers in the front of the plane think they're flying Emirates, and the ones in the middle, they think the branding is United, and the ones in the rear think the branding is, I don't know, you know, somebody else. So.
Right. Yeah. Wow. Exactly.
Yeah. I'm big on branding, and I'm amazed. I'm glad that this PSIP technology was developed to help stations maintain their identity, which is critical for them. It's how people refer to most TV stations, by the channel number.
Sure. You don't know the calls. You don't know the call letters. You know the number. Yeah.
Right.
So
right.
That's what's happening.
So now New York City, you're working with the public stations, and tell me about what is that situation unique? There are two public stations. Most town, my town here in Nashville, we have one public TV station.
Yeah. Right. Right. And in the bigger cities, the very large cities, you have two or more in some cases. That's unusual. What's also unusual in this case is that those two stations in New York City are operated by the same licensee. So it's a duopoly. And that doesn't happen very often either, in either commercial or non-com environments. And so what it's led to is this kind of unique arrangement where a single operator could do their own transition, because let's face it, that model we talked about with the lighthouse, I used the example of five. Sometimes there's more, sometimes there's less, but it's always a sizable group. But you really only need to do it in with two. And in fact, what we're learning as we go along here is that it might be actually better to do this as a series of pairs rather than one big group. You get it done faster because you don't have to go through this multiple stages of first one, then two, then three, four, then five convert, and you rescan each time. The consumer has to rescan each time. Broadcasters have to do their own dance, as does cable if they're getting the signals off the air. Not a lot of them do anymore, but that's still an issue, and it's part of the regulations that you have to give cable notice way in advance that you're going to do this kind of channel sharing hopping around for the 1.0 signal. But if you just did it in pairs, that's actually easier, faster, and simpler, and it also avoids that problem of having to really load up the old 1.0 channel with a lot of other signals that eventually are going to be too many for a single station to carry in these larger transitions. So everybody is looking at this like, maybe we should do this. And that's where I came up with the term dance partner, just to say one to one, even though you might have a market that's got 10, 12, 15 stations, you could do it. And maybe some of them just do it as pairs. Maybe there's a couple that do it as a threefer. But, you know, rather than trying to get one big group to do it all at in this multi-step process. So that is what some other broadcasters, even commercial broadcasters, are looking at in smaller markets. But it's certainly the case for the one in this number one market that WNET is going to do, because, as I say, they have this unique capability of being completely controlling their own destiny, because they own two almost identical coverage stations, full power TV stations, both of which are now transmitting from the new World Trade Center tower. So getting a good signal over the whole New York Metro, and they're both there. So that's, you know, if you can go through the process of what I was talking about with the five station example, it's easy. A lot easier to think about how you do it with two stations. But as I say, you don't get that opportunity to do it as jointly owned two stations, but you could certainly do it with two separate station owners doing it in pair. It would be a lot easier to do. But, you know, it only covers those two stations in the market. The rest of the stations have to do their own kind of pairing up. One other point, though, about public broadcasting that's different is that public broadcasting has been traditionally, and is till today, the biggest user of multicast services, the .2, .3, .4, and they use it for quality content, current content, I shouldn't say it. Quality. I mean, it's like their use of the multicast is more data intensive, let's say, than some of the other the traditional typical commercial stations. Commercial stations didn't use it at all for a long time. Public stations were the only ones using multicast, and now they use it a lot. And then so public TV, the PBS type stations, generally run a mainstream and three other SD, but high quality SD, 480i widescreens technically, services that come from PBS and are carried pretty much by all PBS stations. But they, you know, and in multi-market, multi-station markets, they try to offset the programming time so that they're not running the same thing at the same time, but they're all doing a lot of multicasting. And so public TV stations often have been left out of these big group transitions that are, you know, there's about 40 markets doing this right now across the country at one stage or another of their transition lighthouse thing. And public TV is, there's a few where public TV stations are involved, but most of them they're not. And the reason is, I think, because they've got all these multicast channels to try to find homes for. And it's a lot more of a burden than a typical commercial station that really only has one signal that they really are, you know, bound to need to have placed on another good signal that covers the same audience pattern that they had before if they go 3.0. But if they have some multicast services, that's, you know, may or may not be as important to them, but typically isn't, whereas PBS really has them all. There's another couple of elements to this, which is that, you know, that broadcasters used to have, well, when cable first came around, there was this rule, the must-carry rule, probably heard of it. It meant that a cable system had to carry all of the local channels, at least the ones that really got into the market if, in terms of RF coverage. If it covered the area that cable service was covering, then they had to carry all those stations. That was must-carry. Well, as time went on, broadcasters were getting carried on cable for free. But then they realized, you know, we should flip the script on this. And cable companies are paying these basic cable services, ESPN, A&E, you name it, Weather Channel, all the services, they're paying them. Why don't they pay us to carry the local content? And it took a while, but the rules and so forth eventually shifted around so that now they said, we're giving up on this must carry. Broadcasters, commercial broadcasters said, forget the must carry. We can opt out of that. Now we're not going to let you carry us unless you pay us. And that has come around along this so-called retransmission consent agreements. And now you hear it a lot of times where you only hear about it when they're renegotiating a contract, a multi-year contract. And all of a sudden some cable company isn't going to carry some broadcaster service, and they, you know, have their saber rattling until they finally settle on a price. And so must carry is kind of a thing of the past because you have retrans now that takes in place of it. And must carry only covered the main service to begin with. The only people who still use must carry are the public broadcasters, because public broadcasters can't collect retransmission by rule. So they give their service freely to the cable service companies. But must carry only makes it only, as I said, covers the main service. And remember, we said they're carrying a lot of multicast channels. Well, as it turned out, there's another rule in place, not really a rule, it's an agreement by the NCTA, the National Cable Television Association. And they made this rule years ago, and they've stuck by it. For public TV, they'll carry those multicast services in their SD, so it's not that big a deal at the moment. But so there's up to four. They'll carry up to four main plus three subchannels in all the NCTA members, which are all the big cable companies around the country, carry that. So abide by that. So public TV does get its multicast channels. They're the only ones who get it carried by cable, but that's by agreement, not by mandate or regulation. So this is the context in which public television has to operate. It's a little different than commercial TV. And there's other little subtle differences too as we get into the 3.0 new rules between public TV and commercial TV in terms of data casting. But in any event, New York City with WNET and WLIW, which used to be on Plainview on Long Island, and now is transmitting, as I said, from World Trade, along with NET. So they have already a set each of services that they need to try to carry. And they're working on it. What we're working on right now is to figure out that WLIW, which is channel 21, UHF, which is better, obviously, for things like mobile TV and other elements of 3.0 that will come along. That is going to be the 3.0 service. And channel 13, which is WNET, the top end, the high VHF spectrum, they'll be the 1.0 service that will carry all the services that both stations used to carry in 1.0. And with some of the work that's been done early on here by WNET and another colleague of ours from the ATSC world, Aldo Cugnini, they've tested encoders, 1.0, ATSC 1.0 encoders, MPEG 2 and video encoders primarily, to see how much you can squeeze. And they found that you could probably get three HD and three SDs on there before it starts looking bad to the normal viewer. So,
and you've mentioned that this is a function of how well the encoder is designed. And I'm a little confused about that. I thought an encoder was an encoder. You tell it the bit rate, it follows a standard, and away you go, and you get what you get. You get what's designed for. But our previous conversation, and now you're saying that there is some benefit to perhaps redesigning or looking at the design of the encoders, that some could be better than others, and squeezing more in there. How does that work?
Well, every codec that's ever been designed, digital lossy codec systems, perceptual mm-hmm. coders, whatever you want to call them, they improve. And in fact, there's literature out there that says there's about typically a 30% improvement over the life of a codec, because codecs get replaced over time, right? But every one of them generally has been able to accomplish by the end of its life, about 30% more efficiency than it could at the beginning of its life, subjectively. In other words, if you say, you know, give it a subjective test and say that's okay and that's objectionable, that dividing line between objectionable and okay moves up about 30% in terms of bitrate efficiency over the life of that codec, because the decoders haven't changed. They're all in all the sets out there, but the encoders have gotten better at making the content fit that bitrate that you want it to fit, and have those decoders still be able to decode it. It allows you, basically they allow it you to get that same, roughly the same subjective quality in fewer bits over time. And that's what's happened. MPEG-2 okay. is probably about at the end of its lifespan now, but this particular transition has caused a lot of encoder manufacturers to really say, let's squeeze that last little bit of blood out of the rock here on MPEG-2, and because we've got a need to do that for the next few years. This is end of life for MPEG-2, at least in the broadcast world. So let's see how good we can get it. And that's what's been happening. And that's why there's a whole bunch of new encoder tests for this old codec in this current transition.
Oh, speaking of codecs, you mentioned that NTSC uses the MPEG-2 codec, and what?
ATSC 1.
ATSC 1. And 3 uses, what is it? What is that codec? HEVC?
It's HEVC, yeah.
And there's some promise of using an intermediate codec to maybe help us out even more, that most of the TVs will decode? The 1.0
TVs? Since MPEG-2 was the codec of the, you know, state of the art back in the 90s and early 2000s when DTV first came on, we've had improvements and new codecs have come along. The main one for video from the MPEG world is, it's been called AVC or H.264. AVC is what most people call it, MPEG-4 AVC sometimes. That is about twice as good as MPEG-2 was, by and large. In other words, twice as efficient. HEVC has come along in the interim, which is twice as efficient as AVC. So what we're doing when we go from 1.0 to 3.0 is leapfrogging actually two generations of codec. So that's where we're getting about 4 times more efficiency just in the video coding. And then the fact that ATSC 3's RF service is more efficient than 1.0's gives you an even more efficiency. Instead of only getting about 19 megabits in the 6 megahertz channel, 3.0 can do a huge range of things, but an average number is around 25. And so you get 25 megabits at the same signal to noise, carrier to noise ratio as 1.0. So all other things being equal, which they were locked in at ATSC 1, but you can vary in 3.0 by trading off payload bits for robustness for mobile TV, let's say, or going the other way, if you wanted to eventually do some, say like 8K, but even 4K full time, you might turn your robustness down if you felt like everybody was getting the signal they needed to with a roof antenna, that kind of thing. So you have lots of choices in 3.0 that you didn't have in 1.0, but setting a, you know, a constant carrier to noise level, you could say you're going to get more bits in that pipe to begin with 3.0. Plus, you can encode more video signals into that number of bits because of the new codec. So that's why we say, wow, generally, okay, it's about a 5-to-1 improvement in terms of the number of channels you can carry. But that, some of that is washed out by the fact if you want to say now you, what you couldn't do in 1.0, you can do in 3.0, and that's Ultra HD, 4K, so forth. So some of that extra bits are going to, a bit rate is going to be taken up if you want to offer that kind of service. So it's a bit of a wash, but point is you can get more in there, and that new codec is a the basis for the bulk of that, HEVC as it's called. Or H.265, it's depending on whether you use MPEG names or ITU names. ITU uses the number. However, there's already another codec that's in being rolled out right now called VVC. That's MPEG's name for it. H.266, the next number up on ITUs. Anything that comes along later than this will probably use that codec, which is yet again another couple, you know, a 2x improvement. So whether or not that makes its way into ATSC 3.0 is a big question right now. But as you mentioned, in this transition we have right now with the 1.0, maybe we could at least get half of the problem that we would have when we get down to having fewer and fewer stations on 1.0 and having to squeeze as many of those signals in from the market. ABC, as it turns out, is being supported by most TVs that are out there today. There's been some tests, and there are, none of them are exhaustive yet to know, but just how many, what percentage of the TVs that are out there, and it's going to vary by market, but for the most part, it's been hard to find a TV that didn't work. Like a station would try overnight, let's say, turning one of its multicast channels instead of using MPEG-2, flipping it to AVC and seeing if TVs still picked it up. And almost all of them do. So there's a move afoot right now to make it official to say that at least for the multicast channels, not the main service, but for the multicast channels like the MyTVs and the Weather Radar and all the other kinds of not main service multicast channels that are out there in the commercial world particularly, that you could get away with putting those on the 1.0 night light, let's say, in AVC, and it would still work for most most users. So that's a possibility as we get further along in the transition that helps a little bit on this squeeze that we're going to run into as we move further forward in that lighthouse model. Again, if you're working with, you know, dance partner pairs, you may not have to do that. And that's not part of the plan, at least currently, what is happening in the New York transition. They want to make sure that no viewer left behind. Probably not going to use that AVC approach, but that's, mm-hmm, you know, still an option for any broadcaster to start thinking about as a possibility. And the regulations aren't really completely locked down on this yet, but it does seem like it looks like the at least the multicast channels, probably only the multicast channels ultimately, will be able to use may be able to use AVC as a viable alternative in the latter parts of the transition.
Skip, I've got questions galore, but I tell you what, Chris Shearer says we got a couple of questions from our live YouTube stream, and cool. Wonder if Chris can come back in and relay those to us.
Absolutely. First one, general statement, TV sets last a long time. So what's the incentive for consumers with 1.0 sets to upgrade?
Right. Well, it kind of mentioned it a little bit. It's to be able to get a lot of the features that you can get on streaming TV today. Multiple language captions, multiple language dialogue, audio, ultra HD, 4K, HDR quality video, immersive sound, and these other personalizable effects that broadcasters will probably start to offer, which is extra stats if you're watching a sports game, maybe high frame rate video for sports going down the road. So it qualitative as well as quantitative improvements, the fact that you can get more services in a market on over the air. And there's a lot of, cable cutting, cord cutting that going on right now. This would probably just plugs right into that that trend to allow users to say, you know what, I'm getting a whole lot of content and it's looking really good over NextGen TV over the air for free. Maybe I don't need that, fat bundle anyway of services provided by my cable or satellite provider. So that's really, quality and quantity improvements.
Gotcha. The other question that popped up here, is there any money to be made by being a host and then after the transition, converting to data casting with one primary service?
Well, that is a model. There's each of these arrangements, market by market, is done bilaterally by the stations that are involved, by the broadcast owners of those stations involved. And sometimes they're done in groups across multiple markets. And so what goes on there is kind of under the table, off the, it's not really something that the commission has much say over or cares about. It's whatever the broadcasters want to do in terms of the arrangement for, and if there is any compensation or if it's just in kind of, reciprocal. But so yeah, there is potential for some potential compensation in a given deal, in a given transition. And then ultimately, when you are 3.0, the rule for commercial stations is that all you will have to do, and this is the current rule, may change, probably won't, is have one main TV service. And if data casting really becomes a business, then you could use all the bandwidth you want as long as you keep one television service operating. And so right now that's speculative, whether or not data casting is going to be a big deal. We've talked about data casting for both radio and TV for years. There's been some business there, but it's never really taken root like a lot of the promise would have set, anticipated in terms of a business. And right now that is something that again is being brought up as with because this is an IP system now, how can that make it be really easy to plug into the existing infrastructure in a one-way distribution? One use case that's being contemplated is software updates to vehicles, which is done already today via the cellular approach, unicast, mm-hmm. one car at a time. It takes a long time and it's expensive. It's possible that broadcast data casting would be able to do that faster and cheaper. And so a lot of the car manufacturers are looking at it right now, in fact. And one indication is that ATSC, it has an annual meeting each year. It's always been in DC forever, as long as they've done it. This year's one coming up will be in June. It's first time it's not going to be in DC. And guess where? Detroit, where there are these tests going on. So there's a pretty big interest in that as a potential business, additional business, ancillary business, let's say, going forward. But again, speculative. But yeah, that's certainly on a lot of people's minds as yet another revenue stream that broadcasters might be able to tap with this next gen system.
Skip, we're about out of time, and I want to give you an opportunity to have the last word and fill us in on anything you feel like you hadn't yet. I'm a little curious to know if, when you get finished with the New York City project and the public TV stations, do you hope to be able to demonstrate anything that other stations could learn? Do you hope to learn anything yourself to see if something works or doesn't work, or is this a pretty straight ahead process? It just needs to be executed and coordinated.
Yeah, I think it really is at this point. The folks at Pearl have done a lot of this great early work, and they've written up some really good resources that other stations can use that are all free on their website. And it's it is incremental as we're going. But as I said, the big change is going from trying to do it as a big group down to a series of pairs. And we'll see, this will probably be one of the first, certainly be in a big market, the first to try to do that and see how well we can kind of optimize the process as we go forward and then share that info to at large to the industry.
Very nice. Skip Pizzi, thank you so much for sharing your time and expertise and getting us all, you know, get our head wrapped around this transition, the mechanics of which can be, you know, a little confusing, troublesome, but also rewarding in the end. And it sounds like it's going to be a few years of moving along, because we can't cut off all these TV sets. For the person who asked about, well, isn't this going to obsolete TV sets? Yeah, but new TV sets are $318 at Walmart.
Yeah, and even the 3.0 ones now are under $500. Even cheaper would be a set-top box if you really had to maintain compatibility on your older sets until they run out. So, yeah, thanks. Great to be with you, you guys, Kirk, and it's really a pleasure to be here on the SBE's channel. Good to see Chris again, and we'll hope to see you all in person at the NAB show, finally back in real life in April in Vegas. So until then, thanks, guys.
Thank you, Chris. This is Skip Pizzi. Hang around if you would for just a minute. And Chris, hand it over to you to take us out. Thank you, sir.
Very good. Well, thanks, Kirk and Skip. This has been the SBE Web Extra, the SBE chapter of the web. We present this monthly, and we hope you'll join us each time. We'll post the replay on our YouTube channel, usually within a day. The SBE Web Extra is sponsored by Catrine, whom we thank for the support. Catrine, unique experience, individual solutions, reliable performance. If you hold SBE certification, viewing the SBE Web Extra qualifies you for 1.5 point in Category G, that's attendance, just like attending a local chapter meeting. And that does it for this installment of the SBE Web Extra from the Society of Broadcast Engineers, the Association for Broadcast and Multimedia Technology Professionals. Thanks again to our guest, Skip Pizzi, and on behalf of Kirk Karnak, we'll see you next month.